lifespan is how long you're going to live. And the health span is how well you're going to age. It depends on three components: physical, cognitive is your brain health, and then emotional, and some part of that is spiritual. So concepts which we're going to be talking about it, and the new science which is coming in US and in West is what weight management is. Old concepts, but there are new things which we'll be discussing why this is important. Diet, exercise, supplements, sleep, stress, skin and hair. It's just this vanity part. I like to take care of myself. So we'll be talking about the skin and hair. For women especially, it's very, I think for men as well, it's very important. If you're aging, you need to look good as well. Bioidentical hormone optimization, which will be the last part of the slide, which is very close to my heart. And that's what I've been working for several decades on it. Not the decades, 5 years, because it's pretty new. The new objectives which I'm going to be talking here is again bioidentical and gut health, which we all ignore as a specialist. We just think that gastroenterologists can take care of the gut health. But as a doctor, no matter what specialty you are in, you need to know the basics of the gut health. Because the gut is connected to your brain, and we'll talk about it as well. Muscle preservation and the new studies about the sauna therapy and the cold water immersion. The muscle mass, the one indicator that is going to decide how independent and how well you are going to age when you're 60s and 70s is the amount of muscle which you have right now. In menopause, 1 in 5 women, probably after 60s, is going to have osteoporosis, the bone fracture. And if anybody has a bone fracture in that age, they become immobile. And once they are immobile, they lose 2 to 3 pounds of muscle mass per week, imagine. And when you age, the biggest reason why you are getting sicker and sicker is because of the disease called sarcopenia, when you start losing muscle. After age 30, you're losing muscle 1 to 2% every year. So if you have more muscle, especially the leg power, you cannot underestimate the leg power. People who are doing the sports, they are going to live healthier and more independent. Why I keep saying independent? Because when you're aging, it's not just to age. You can live 100 years, but if your quality of life is bad and you're dependent on others, you're wheelchair ridden, what's the point? So that's what we're going to be discussing today, what you can do to delay the aging, but age well. How to increase the muscle mass? Of course, through your diet, anything which is protein, the red meat. We need 100 gram, and depending on your weight and size and height, how much you need, probably the need would go higher. But the minimum you can do is chop kebab, champagne, all this red meat. This is the best source. You need at least 100 gram everyday red meat. And then you need muscle strengthening and muscle resistance exercise. I do my weights are in my office as well. I keep doing the weight exercises because the more muscle mass you have, the lesser sicker you are going to get. Muscle has like the glucose metabolism is happening there. Muscle has a lot of mitochondria sticking to the heart. So you need to preserve your muscle now so you can age well later. If you get into an accident, God forbid, the more muscle mass you have, your recovery will be faster. The weight management, I'm going to go over the slides a little bit quicker because the longevity for the women which I run the clinic is especially for the women, but the first half of this lecture is for the men, is the gender regardless, it's for men and women. We'll be talking about the bioidentical in the end. So the balanced diet, of course, we all know this. There is no secret behind. And then if you need to do exercise regularly, the science has shown if you do 1 hour exercise every day, it is going to increase the life expectancy by 3 hours. So imagine if you've been doing if you've been exercising all your life starting at 30, every 1 hour will add 3 hours to your life expectancy. Maintaining the healthy lifestyle, we'll talk about it, but nowadays there are so many GLP-1, Mounjaro, Wegovy, Ozempic, weight loss injections. I do prescribe that to my diabetic patient. I do prescribe that to morbidly obese people who have their pressure and cannot control their hemoglobin A1C. But if you're using that, you will lose muscle mass very rapidly. If you're doing natural weight loss through supplements, through exercising, 2/3 of that weight loss will be from the fat. 1/3 probably you'll lose muscle. But if you are taking shortcut, which is GLP-1 weight loss injections, which is so common nowadays, you will start having the Ozempic face. Your fat will be losing from the face as well, you will start looking older. The reason being because you will be using 2/3 of muscle mass, not the fat loss. So that's not the healthy way. If you have to give Ozempic and these weight loss injections to your patients, please tell your patients start from a very, very low dose, stay on a low dose for a longer period of time, add more meat. I know there is appetite suppressant, they will not be able to feed themselves, or they say, oh, we are not feeling hungry, but you have to make sure they are taking, they are adding more meat to their diet. And they start doing exercises, which includes weight training. I cannot emphasize more than this. You have to tell everybody who wants to age well, they have to include not just the morning walk and the evening walk, which we all Pakistanis do after the food. We have to start doing the weight lifting. Keto diets, of course, the diet has to be balanced. We all know as doctors, this is a very basic step. The protein and the fat and carbohydrates, we have to add fiber and prebiotics and probiotics. Prebiotics and probiotics is going to improve your gut health. And you know, of course, that the prebiotics, probiotics, and every gut, your skin, your vagina, everywhere there is a microbes, which are the living organisms. The living organisms are virus, bacteria, fungi, which are living in your gut, and they tell you how healthy you're going to be. You know, when I was a medical student, I was never able to understand the immunology. That was the subject which I hated, because it's not tangible. I could never figure out, like, where is these immune cells? I don't know what these doctors are talking about, because I don't think even my teacher knows where the immune cells are, because I can't see with my eyes. When you're doing anatomy, you can see the nerves, you can see the muscles, but you can't see the immune cells and all these cytokines and fancy words they're talking in the immunology. But 70-80% of your immune system is outside the gut. So now we know if your gut is not healthy, your skin disease, psoriasis, eczema, your arthritis, inflammation in the body goes up. So the first line of defense is your gut flora. Your gut is connected to your brain, and we should be very excited to know that your the gut also produces neurotransmitters. Dopamine, serotonin, and norepinephrine, all these neurotransmitters are produced not only in the brain, this is also produced in the gut. So they're all interconnected, and they're connected to the vagus nerve, which is a parasympathetic and is a relaxing and calming nerve. So whatever you're putting in your stomach is going to have an effect on your brain as well. So the depression, anxiety, stress goes down if your gut is healthy. How do you know that your gut is healthy? When you're younger, you can eat anything and you can get away with it. But when you get older, your gut microbes, the flora is changing, the pH is changing, then whatever you put in, you get bloated, like you have the heartburn, and you keep going to these gastroenterologists, and they just put you on all these kind of omeprazole, proton inhibitors, and you're on it for years and years, and nothing is changing. They keep coming back, they just change the name of the medicine, but nothing works. The gut flora is obviously damaged, and you need to bring the flora back. Not only that, sometimes you need to ask your gastroenterologist as well. Maybe if you've been on the proton inhibitors for so long, your hydrochloric acid, which is protected from the bacteria and from the outside components, is decreased actually because of the excessive use of these medicines. And they need to bring the hydrochloric acid back. And just the esophageal sphincter might be relaxed, and they just, you don't have to be on all these omeprazole and proton inhibitors for so long. So you need to discuss with the gastroenterologist. I'm not a specialist for that, but I do believe in the gut flora. Something for the gynecologist here, estrobilong. Estrobilong is the colony of the bacteria which is living in your gut. And this is the colony of the bacteria which controls and regulates the estradiol and all different kinds of estrogen metabolism. So we know that 100% estrogen, which is estradiol, which is the bioidentical, is produced by your ovaries. So in the ovaries, there is testosterone, and there is an enzyme which is called aromatase, which works on the testosterone and changes it to estradiol, which is 100% bioidentical, and that's why we stay youthful, and then start producing it, we are able to have babies. The adrenal glands also produce testosterone, but they also change in the adipose tissue directly, indirectly. Adrenal gland produce all these estrogen and the hormones, sex hormones. But the estradiol is not produced by the adrenal gland. the hormone which is produced by there after the menopause is called estrogen. So the basic estrogen, because the estrogen is a family of hormones. It's just like vitamin B1, 12, 6. It's not just called estrogen. There are so many estrogens. And one of them which is more prevalent in the menopause is called estrogen, which is pro-inflammatory. So by definition, the menopause is the stage of inflammation. Why I'm bringing this here? Because in perimenopause, in menopause and PCOS patients, and so many men and women have the disturbed, damaged flora of the gut, and they keep working on other aspects. You go to the arthritis, the rheumatologist, they give you the medicine. You go to the gastroenterologist, you go to the psychiatrist, they all put you with anti-anxiety and anti-depression. So first line of defense should be the gut flora. You have to work on that and bring it back to normal. So the estrobilome, what does that do? I did mention that. Your estradiol and all different kind of estrogens, they get conjugated through the liver and through the bile duct, it goes into the stomach, and there is this colony of the bacteria, beautiful bacteria living there, which they are going to work on that conjugated estrogens. So the conjugated estrogens, some part of that will be conjugated, will be excreted through your body, you get rid of it. Some part of that will be deconjugated because of the presence of the beta-glucuronidase. This is the enzyme which is produced by that colony which is called estrobilome. So that's why the estrobilome is so important. And the balance between how much is conjugated, how much is unconjugated will depend. The whatever is unconjugated will go and enter in your bloodstream back. So that is why sometimes we say there is estrogen dominance. Sometimes we say the balance between the progesterone and estrogen is disturbed. So the estrobilome is the colony of bacteria which is living in your gut, is deciding how much healthy is that and how much estrogen you have. And because of that, PCOS and because of that, the menopausal women suffer a lot because their gut is damaged, their gut flora is damaged. Exercise. The number one indicator, the clinical research has shown that if you really want to know how well you're going to age and how long you're going to live, is the VO2 max. VO2 max is the oxygen consumption from your muscles when you are exercising. So if you go to the sports medicine doctor, they can check your VO2. If your VO2 max is normal, the overall mortality rate goes down by 11%. So the VO2 max is so important. Indirectly, what I'm saying, the exercise is so important. If you go and check all these Olympians, you check athletes, the elite athletes, their VO2 max is really high. I mean, then they can die any time. If we're talking about if they live longer, they're going to be very healthy because they'll have longer muscle, they'll have more muscle mass, and your VO2 mass is going to determine which indirectly is correlated with the muscle mass. So the VO2 mass tells like how long and how well you're going to age. These are the graphs. You can just know your, like, if your age is less than 29, let's say the average age sitting here is 13, 39, or 14, 49. The poor, fair, average, good, and excellent is for elite athlete. The good is 39 to 44, which is for 40 to 49 years of women. The last one was for the men, and this is for women chart. So if they're 40 to 49, their good VO2 max will be 36.3. That will tell you that your mortality rate would be decreased by 11%. Sleep cycle. Sleep cycle, of course, again, this is the basic, this is a circadian rhythm. We are diurnal animals, we are not nocturnal. We are not supposed to hunt at night time. And when I was a student, I always used to think, why these women go to labor at night? Why don't they just go in the middle? And like, we always get calls in the middle of the night, the baby's coming out. It's like so distressing for us. And then we realized the women's cycle is following the lunar, and it's all cyclical. So people who are doing the night duties, sometimes they are more prone, more vulnerable to depression, anxiety, and stress because their circadian rhythm is affected. The melatonin, which is produced in your brain at nighttime when the sun goes down, is helping you to sleep. If you are using all these gadgets, you are getting this blue light from the gadgets, which is going to decrease the melatonin, and your sleep cycle will be disturbed. So the sunrise also wakes you up, so which is all these different kind of infrared are telling you to wake up. The melatonin is telling you go to sleep. So So people who are sleeping well, their stress level will be down and their longevity will be better. And not only that, how well it would be, it depends on that. The ashwagandha, I was just saying, it's not a longevity medicine. But I have written it here because it's an herbal supplement and I'm not the herbalist, but there is a clinical scientific studies which shows that it decreases cortisol level. That's why people who are using ashwagandha at night time, they can sleep better, or who are using in the morning also, they have less stress because of the suppression of cortisol. So there are many supplements out there which have not proven that will increase the longevity directly, but they can increase the longevity indirectly because they are decreasing cortisol level, which is a very important hormone for stress. How to manage your stress? I always say through the breathing exercises, through sauna, through cold water immersion, through yoga. Breathing exercises we should all learn, we should teach our, I think it should be the part of the teaching. For the emotional intelligence to raise that and to decrease the stress. If you are in some situation where there is stress, you take a deep breath in, deep, 4 seconds, hold it, then breathe in for 7 seconds, let it out through your mouth, 4, 8 seconds. So you need to do that multiple times when you are going through some stress, and you do go through the stress day and day at so many occasions, so many situations. Ashwagandha, as I said, is just a herbal supplement. You can use it because there is scientific study, but it's not a longevity medicine. We'll be talking what increases the longevity. The sauna increases the longevity. There is so much science behind it now. The exposure at 80 degrees centigrade, 20 minutes 4 to 5 times per week. If you do the sauna, it decreases the 50% causes of cardiovascular disease. Sauna increases the growth hormones. It helps you to recover from inflammation. It helps to recover the damaged muscles as well. It decreases the pain, inflammation, arthritis, and it decreases all-cause mortality by 40%. It is very high. 40% of all-cause mortality is decreased. If you are going to the gym, tell your wives, and go and spend 20 minutes in the sauna. This is good for me and this is good for family as well because we've been living longer and living better. All women then should be doing this. Cold water immersion, you can just sit in the bucket full of ice water or in cold water, in cold season in Pakistan, if you don't have the ice bucket, just use the cold water, which is pretty cold. And the minimum effective dose for the cold water immersion is 10 degrees centigrade, 11 minutes exposure per week. You're not going to sit and in the cold water for 11 minutes, you're going to be affected by the hypothermia, but you're going to break down that 11 minutes into segments, like you can do 1 or 2 minutes every day. Some people ask me, like, can you do the sauna and the cold water therapy? Yes, you can do that. It will have the multiple effect, it's going to be a cumulative effect. You can just do the sauna before and after that, you can just do the cold shower, very, very cold shower. It has to be 10 degrees centigrade. That's the minimum effective doses, which I'm saying. So the sauna and the cold water, they're pretty new concepts and they do work. There is a lot of research behind it. If anybody wants to know the NIH papers or sort of the PubMed, or there are some other clinical societies where we get all the research, I can email it to you if you want to come and connect with me personally. Supplements are very important. If somebody tells you you can get it from food, we just cannot. Our food is processed, and the amount of the food you will have to eat to meet the daily requirement of certain supplements is not going to happen. So there's a lot of supplements here. I'm going to go one by one, which are important, and there is science behind it that increases the science shows that they are for longevity. Magnesium. Please, everybody should be on magnesium. There is a maki here. I'm sorry, I'm just getting mixed up with that. So magnesium. Everybody should be on the magnesium. It's 70% population, even in US, is deficient. So imagine the rest of the world when they are very deficient in magnesium. If you check the blood levels of the magnesium, you cannot check through the blood because the deficiency is not going to be reflected. What happens when you check the blood test, the bone gives you the magnesium, and the bones start getting brittle, but the levels of magnesium in the blood will be shown normal. So usually we check the magnesium RBC, but regardless, I put all my patients in the longevity clinic on the magnesium supplement. There are different kinds of magnesium. depending on the need of the patient, we decide that what needs to be given to them. It helps with the brain health, with the bone health, and the gut health. This is very important. The magnesium, vitamin D, and magnesium run together as well. If you have some anxiety, depression, you have sleep issues, and restless leg syndromes, arthritis, and your muscles are achy, fatigue, you should give magnesium glycinate. If you have memory issues, your cognitive issues, to improve the cognitive issues and memory and as well as sleep, you should give magnesium threonate. Magnesium threonate is the only magnesium which can cross the blood-brain barrier. So that's why most of the psychiatrists also use it when people come to them with anxiety and depression. The dose, look at the dose, 300 to 400 milligrams per day. You cannot get it through the food, as I said, because if you get it from the egg, let's just say the egg is a good source of magnesium. You will have to eat 60 eggs per day to meet the daily requirement. We don't eat 60 eggs. So even if you are doing through the food, the beef, the eggs, avocados and other plants, it's not going to be very healthy. These are just how the magnesium works. These are the studies which shows the calcium, magnesium and vitamin D3 with K2 works. I'm not going to go over the detail of the clinical research. Vitamin D3 and K2. I give all my patients who come to my longevity clinic vitamin D3 plus K2. Why K2? I'll talk about that later. But vitamin D3 you can get through your skin, through sunlight exposure, or you can get through the supplements. I don't try to get vitamin D3 through skin under the sunlight exposure, because sunlight can cause the aging, it can cause the wrinkles, it can cause the dark spots and melasma, and I do like to not have those things. So I don't have wrinkles, so I don't get it from sunlight and sun exposure. I like my supplements. I'm a nighttimer, but I do go out during the day, early morning, when there is not a very sharp sun out there, to avoid photoaging. The sun is the best source of photoaging. There are some enzymes in your skin, metalloproteinases, which can cause the damaging of the collagen. The collagen goes down and you start getting older. So if you really don't care, you can go out in the sun, which is a great source, but it's not for me. So you have to decide what it is. Vitamin D3, why do I give K2 with it? Because there are different kinds of K2. There are K4 and K7. I usually do MK7. There's MK4 and K7. MK7 is a better bioavailability. So whenever you are giving K2, it should be MK7. And I take vitamin D3 with it. Because if you're giving too much vitamin D3 and you're not changing the blood levels, the hypercalcemia can happen. And that can go into the arteries. And of course, it goes into the arteries, can have the cardiovascular issues. So the K2 is navigating the vitamin D3. It helps the calcium to stay in the bones and is navigating it well so it doesn't go into the arteries. So that's why you can say indirectly it is preventing from the overtoxicity of vitamin D3. So the combination, if you're giving it to them, vitamin D3 and K2, you don't have to worry about the overtoxicity of vitamin D3. Also, the clinical research has shown if somebody uses a very high dose of vitamin D3 for 14 days with K2, it decreases the overall mortality and it helps increasing, it treats the bursitis, arthritis, inflammation of the body. You have to give it to your patients only for 14 days, high dose, and they will feel better if they're having these body aches and arthritis and bursitis. The daily dose is 2,000 and 5,000, some do 10,000. Why we can do 10,000 and why not the lower dose? Because the higher dose are needed for the inflammation. If you're working on the inflammation of the patient, you should do the higher dose. The vitamin D, as I said, the sunlight is a very good source for the vitamin D3. If we are white people, we are not white, because what I work with the Caucasian and white people, their exposure, they go to the bathing on the skin, and they're in very skimpy clothes. Their body mass surface, which is exposed to the sun, for 30 minutes, it can produce 50,000 IU, which is pretty high. But the brown skin, we are Desi people, I'm sorry, we call it brown there, so I'm pretty accustomed to that. The 30 minute exposure would produce 20,000 IU, which is pretty meeting all the need, what you need daily. But you would have to expose yourself to the sun every day regularly for 30 minutes without, I mean, with the maximum exposure without wearing the long sleeves, and you know, the back skin again produces less because the melanin which is present in your skin also makes your like how much vitamin D3 you're producing. Omega 3, you cannot emphasize more. Everybody should be on omega 3. The best source is the lunch meat, the fish, the mackerel, the salmon, tilapia, and all those things, oysters, shrimp, but they are not, we're not eating a lot to meet the requirement. Everybody should be on omega 3. It has EPA, DHA, and you know 20% of your brain is made up of DHA. It is very important for brain, it is very important for your heart health as well. If you take the omega 3 on very early stages, it will decrease the risk of the cardiovascular diseases, your dementia, and Alzheimer's disease. The one thing and the disease which I'm most afraid of when I get older, inshallah, is the Alzheimer's disease, because I want to know the names of my kids and my husband and my wife, they are the loved ones. I don't want to leave this world not knowing who is who. So Alzheimer's disease is the number one factor also. If you want to prevent that, start using omega 3. It decreases overall mortality by 27%. The best source, of course, is the animal and fatty fish. The daily dose is 1 to 2 grams daily. Again, there's so many research behind it. It's an evidence-based science. The new research has pretty much proven the fact.
Talking about NMN,
which is the energy precursors, if you can afford, or your relatives that are living in US, then you can ask them, which I do. My bags are full of collagen and US erythritol. These are the things which are still being studied. These are not the proven medications. They're still working on it, but it doesn't have side effects. So many longevity symposiums are recommending NMN, which is the energy precursors, and it helps to damage the DNA. As we age, of course, our DNA is getting damaged, so it repairs the damaged DNA, and it works on the aging genes, which are the sirtuins. So NMN is a precursor of NAD. And resveratrol and hydrogen water bottle. Skincare is not for longevity, and as I said, I just believe that if you're getting older, you need to take care of yourself as well. Just the three basic components, I'm going to just go over that very quickly. Face wash in the morning, moisturizer every 4 or 5 hours depending on the type of your skin, and then sunblock, sunscreen, which when you're going out, every 2-3 hours. Please do not damage your skin, do not photoage your skin when you're going out. And at night, you have to add retinols and tretinoin. I know men might not be very much interested in the wrinkle prevention, but nowadays they are. You should be adding tretinoin to your skincare routine after age 25. It induces the collagen, it prevents the formation of the wrinkles. After age 25, all women, girls, men should be using tretinoin and adaptively or retinols. This is all the same category under vitamin A derivatives. It works, it produces collagen. So you're taking the collagen by mouth and you're putting the collagen to induce collagen, the retinols and tretinoin on your skin. Again, this is anti-aging, and copper peptide also produces the collagen. That's also anti-aging. If women, I know the women are more interested in that, they want to add extra anti-aging supplements to their skin. Sunscreen, we already talked, it should be mineral sunscreen for Pakistani people, for brown people. It should be mineral, it should not be chemical, it should be more than SPF 30, and it should be broad spectrum, which is covering UVA and UVB. Skin brightening agent, I just put it for the young girls because everybody wants to be Gora in Pakistan. The IV injections which are being used for the skin Gora currently, they have no studies behind it, they should not be used. By mouth, you can offer them glutathione, which is antioxidant, it works. The hair care, everybody who's aging, of course, they're going to lose their hair. Because of the menopause in women, it gets thinner, and men lose their because of the testosterone as well, and DHT. So I just tell them one thing before you go to sleep, just start using minoxidil 5% every night. It will stop their hair fall. So if you don't want to do anything else, just start using minoxidil 5%. Perimenopause and menopause, which is very, very close to my heart, and this is what I specialize in. So if we have time, I can go into detail about it, about the bioidentical hormone replacement therapy. Otherwise, I'm going to keep it very short. So how much time I have to talk about the perimenopause and bioidentical hormone replacement therapy? 5 minutes? So WHI study, which came 20-25 years ago, they were using synthetic hormones, which are totally different than the bioidentical hormones. Synthetic hormones which they use were conjugated estrogen, which was obtained from the urine of a horse. Even the horse didn't want that conjugated estrogen, they were excreting in urine. They took it out, they made the synthetic hormones, and they started using it in the research, which is the WHI study. And the second part of the hormone which was given to them, the progesterone, was medroxyprogesterone. Both are not bioidentical. They have nothing to do with the body. The women, when they're younger and healthier, their ovaries do not produce those hormones. But the WHI studies use those chemicals, which is the synthetic hormone replacement therapy. And of course, they find out that the risk of the breast cancer was going a little higher. And they saw that the colon cancer, of course, the risk was less. And the hormone replacement therapy, when you use, the rate of the colorectal cancer goes down. But the breast cancer risk was going up. So they discontinued the study abruptly. And they said, oh, we cannot use these hormones. And now, since 25 years, the doctors were not trained in the hormones. When you're doing the residency or when you're doing the OBGYN house job here, they don't talk about the menopause much. They don't talk about the hormones much, because we've been told the hormones are bad. They can cause the breast cancer. They can cause the clots. They should not be used. But those were synthetic hormones. outcomes. The study which was done was flawed. So now the recently the guidelines from A. Morgan NAMS North American Menopause Society, and apart from where we all get the certification, where the board certified if you're practicing in the West, the new guidelines are about the bioarticular hormone replacement therapy. Bioarticular hormone replacement therapy are not the synthetic hormones. These are the hormones which are produced by your ovaries. What does the ovary produce? It produces estradiol, 100% estradiol. Then you are at the peak of your fertility, when you are 20-year-old, and when you are younger and healthier, the estradiol is working on all the receptors that you do. So when the eggs diminish, when you are in perimenopause and menopause, the eggs are not producing the estradiol, of course, and then you start having the symptoms. So those symptoms, of course, we get cranky when you're in 40s, you cannot sleep, you have hot flashes, mood swings, you start fighting with your husband, you feel like you want to cry, anxiety, depression all the time, and then the bone gets brittle, you start developing osteopenia, osteoporosis, and then memory loss, memory fog, and sexual dysfunction. The women just complain they don't have no libido, they have no sexual desire, and even the sex part, the intercourse part is very painful because of the vaginal atrophy, because the estradiol is not working on their vaginal mucosa, then they start having the recurrent urinary tract infections. All these things have to do is being affected. Their gut flora also changes, they cannot just eat anything, whatever you eat is like, they have either masturbation or diarrhea. So all these things, if somebody is telling you, you can just do the phytoestrogens, which is the plant based, and you can just get the chia seed, flaxseed, yarn, these things will help you. Yes, it will help you for the short-term symptoms that you're experiencing, the hot flashes and the mood swings. But it is not going to protect you, which is going to happen in your body after 25 years, when you're 65 years of age. Because in menopause, women are living. If you just look at like centuries ago, women were dying after the childbirth. The only purpose was to have the kids. And at 33, the life expectancy was max 33 or 40, and they used to die. So now women are in menopause at average age 51, and nobody is dying. They are living till 80, 81, or maybe 90s. If you want to live, then you need to get bioidentical hormone replacement therapy, because the long-term side effects which you're having because of the deficiency of estradiol can be protected only through bioidentical. What is bioidentical? That's the hormone estradiol, and the other hormone, which is progesterone. The progesterone is micronized by mouth, and estradiol bioidentical should be given through transdermal route, because it's not going to go through your liver. Unfortunately, there is no bioidentical transdermally present through the gel cream on the arms in Pakistan. So why I come here? I'm in the middle of this mission, and this is my vision, that I want to bring the transdermal route of the bioidentical, inshallah, very soon. So the women here, you're going through the perimenopause and menopause, you will have the real bioidentical. It doesn't mean that you cannot give estradiol, but that estradiol will be going through the liver and then will be conjugated, and the end metabolite will be different as compared to the estradiol. So it's not going to be total bioidentical. The bioidentical is not causing the inflammation, it's not pro-inflammatory, it is anti-inflammatory. If the person does not have the risk factors already, you should be offering it to them. It actually decreases the breast cancer risk, because it is decreasing the cancer of the because the cancer is causing. Why does the cancer happen? It's causing anywhere in the body because of inflammation. So if you're decreasing the inflammation, you're decreasing the risk. So bioidentical actually decreases the breast cancer risk. It decreases the risk of the clots. It doesn't cause the clots also. You just have to make sure that you're selecting the right person. They do not have a personal history of breast cancer already. Because estrogen, which is produced from the adrenal glands, is the pro-inflammatory. That's not the hormone which is going to protect you. The only hormone which will protect your bones and from Alzheimer's is the bioidentical, which is estradiol and micronized progesterone. So if you offer that to your patients, or your aunties, fofos, khalas, mothers are on it, it's going to be beneficial for them. They're going to age well, and that is called the hormone optimization. So people ask me, what is hormone optimization? In the olden days, when they were giving the synthetic hormones, because of the side effects and complications, they were saying, just give the HRT for a very small dose for a very short time. Now the guidelines are, you should not be giving it to the patients short time or short dose. You should be giving the right dose in the optimum dose, which is going to increase the quality of life so women can age well. And it should be offered bioidentical, not the synthetic hormones. So if you give it to them, what's going to happen? You see that you're going to get that woman, you're going to change that to this woman. So you'll get a beautiful woman who's going to be less cranky. And these are my handles. I'm on Insta, TikTok, YouTube, and all the social media. If you have any questions, you can connect me through there, or I'm ready for the question answer session.